So yeah, so it's going to be slightly different, and I'm just going to title it The Fear of a Funeral. It's just, we were worshiping and it just came, and so I had Danny print some notes that I wrote down. If you have a Bible, and I'm just going to share with you, I believe this is for somebody, and if it's not for somebody, it'll be just for me. For all of us, amen. Or somebody maybe watching on live stream will be watching it very soon. Exodus chapter 14 and verse 12. Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again, no more, forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Fear is natural, yet demonic. The Bible says in 2 Timothy, and Zaki quoted, chapter 1, verse 7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear. That tells us that fear is not only an emotion. Fear can start as an emotion. It can turn into a spirit. You can start first being afraid of something. You have logical explanation. And then when fear moves from an emotion and it begins to control your reaction, changes your confession, and paralyzes you in your current situation, and it blocks the promises of God in the future, you can know one thing: you're not dealing with an emotion, you're dealing with a spirit. And this spirit is to hold you back from your future and hold you connected to your past. Fear is not only a spirit, but it can be an emotion. It can be an emotion, but it's also a spirit. Fear is also, it changes our focus, because what fear does is it magnifies the past and it shuts down the future. What fear does is the fear glorifies the problem and it minimizes the promise. What fear does is it makes us have an amnesia where we forget what God did and we only remember what God hasn't done. What fear causes us to do is we lose focus. Israel is there. They just experienced the great miracle of Exodus. God did an amazing work. And there they are saying that it would have been better to be slaves. Completely forgot the perspective that slavery wasn't fun. It wasn't good. And they said it would have been better that we died as slaves than we die as people in the wilderness. Fear will mess with your focus. It's a focus problem. Fear messes with your perspective. You don't see things in the right perspective. You see things blurred and twisted. Fear not only messes with our perspective and it changes our focus, but fear also, it paralyzes and changes our confession. We begin to speak things that are not in line with our faith. We begin to speak things that are in line with our feelings. We begin to say things like, I am sick, instead of saying, I am healthy fighting sickness. We begin to identify ourselves no longer with Jesus, we identify ourselves with our symptoms. We no longer say, I am righteous fighting sin, we say, I am a sinner trying to get righteous. Our confession begins to change, and confession is very important, because whatever constantly comes out of your mouth will dictate the direction of your life. If we confess things that are negative constantly, I'm not saying that you have a bad day once in a while and you kind of, you know, said stuff and you know you had a difficult day and you let somebody have it and you vomited your feelings. There's nothing wrong with that. We all have that. That's part of being a human. The problem is if that day has become your lifestyle. If only once in a while positive things come out, but the moment somebody cuts you open, you bleed negativity, you bleed pessimism, you bleed the reality. Your confession reflects your circumstances instead of reflecting the promises of God. When David faced Goliath, David did not look at Goliath in panic and fear. He looked at him with faith and he says, today is going to be your funeral. And I'm so sorry. You should have warned your mom. This is your last day. You're dead, bro. You're gone. I mean, there's faith was in that. A woman had a bleeding problem and she says, as I touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. Confession in her heart directed her toward her miracle. When you have fear, you begin to say things like, I'm going to die. Why is bad things happening to me? Fear, it affects your speech. It affects your confession. It makes you complain more, praise less. It makes you ask more, worship less. Because fear dictates your confession. Fear, see, faith moves mountains. Fear creates them. Faith will move mountains. Fear will build them. Faith will overthrow the giants and fear will make them permanent and make them concrete. Faith is the thing of the Holy Spirit. It's inside of our spirit and faith is as real. Faith is seeing things that are not there as though they are there. Now, our five senses, everybody here has five senses. Hopefully they all work, function pretty well. But a lot of our senses, they rely on other senses. For example, my mind relies, my ears, my mouth, my nose, and my touch will rely a lot on my eyes. If my eyes see something, my ears don't have to hear it. I believe it because my eyes just told me. If my ears hear something, my eyes don't have to see it. Like my eyes don't see music. My ears hear it and my eyes believe it to be true. The rest of my senses submit to one sense. And we have to understand same thing happens with our faith. Your faith is one more sense. It's called your spiritual sense. Where you trust the word of God, you believe that to be true. And you act as though it's true. And your reality and your senses, they submit to that truth. That you will be healed, that you will have a breakthrough, that you will see your family coming to know the Lord, that as long as there's a breath in your nostrils, that God is working out an answer and a solution for you, that God is in the business working for you.